WA might be a fossil fuel powerhouse, but for the first time ever, renewables have overtaken gas as the state's largest source of power. All mainland states registering record highs for renewable generation in 2021. Whoa. Meanwhile, across the national energy market, gas generation fell to 15-year lows, with Victoria seeing a 39% drop. In New South Wales, gas now making up just 1.5% of the state's power.
There's five times as much renewable energy in the system as there is gas in the system, which is really quite amazing. So renewable energy is just powering forward and gas is going backwards.
And that's raising questions over the federal government's
gas-fired recovery plan.
Basically, the gas cannot compete with the renewable energy. We're seeing more solar on people's roofs. We're seeing more wind farms being put in place. Cheap electricity into the system is driving gas out.
In more bad news for fossil fuels, AGL has announced it'll be closing Bayswater and Loy Yang B, two of the country's biggest, dirtiest coal-fired plants, several years ahead of schedule. The coalition's all about
can-do capitalism, not don't-do government.
So you'd think they'd be happy to let the free market take the lead, right? Not quite.
The exit of such a considerable amount of reliable generation is a concern for the continued reliability and affordability of the system.
He doesn't seem to have the ability to grasp the fact that the world is moving on. If we do not decide to win on climate change, if we lose the opportunities to build an export industry built on excess electricity, built on hydrogen, built on ammonia.
The green transition's picking up pace. So is the government's gas-led recovery over before it's even begun?
Dr Adam Bumpus is a climate change expert and joins us once again. So, Adam, it seems like the market is making this call, irrespective of what the government has to say or what policies it really wants to roll out on this issue. So does it matter what the government does?
Well, yeah, the market is speaking. You know, renewables are the cheapest form of electricity in the world and we're powering ahead, as we saw. But, yeah, the government has a really strong role to play in here still. You see governments all over the world taking action. They're all taking action. And the government here has an opportunity here to help this transition happen well, make it more comfortable for people, make sure that we're taking that real grasp on what this future could look like and making profitability out of it for everybody. That's the role of the government in this transition.
So on the flip side, the government is still intent on making gas-fired electricity a dominant part of the mix. Do they actually have any say?
Look, the challenge of this making a gas-fired recovery plan part of it, really a dominant part of the mix, makes no sense whatsoever. And so it's all about what does the government really want to do here? Do we want to build a strong economy based on clean energy that the whole world is moving to? This is inevitable. It's like the train has left the station already. They need to run and catch up and jump on the back of it. And they have this massive role to play there in fostering the way these new technologies, the way communities will respond, and the way we can really deal with this transition in the very best way. That's the role of government. All over the world, we see it. It's super clear.
So, Adam, if continuing to produce fossil fuels makes no economic sense, what does the government gain from delaying a transition?
Yeah, it's inertia. It's really hard to see. To be honest, from an economic point of view, when we look at this, it's very hard to see. But if you look at a political economic point of view, basically it's old interests, keeping old interests happy, making sure that the status quo remains for as long as possible. And I think that is really where the challenge is. There is a new status quo coming, and it's coming really fast. Just all those statistics around renewable energy, people like Mike Cannon-Brookes jumping into the debate, there's a whole bunch of technologies coming through which are going to be really normal in about 10 years' time. It's just this one moment now where we can make the decision to either jump on that train or stay in the station.
Well, the Energy Minister has warned that the AGL decision will jeopardise supply and prices. But given we're already seeing this surge in renewable generation, does that stack up at all?
Yeah, not really. Look, there is an issue with lots of renewable generation going into the grid and making sure that that electricity is available to the people at the right times. But there are swathes of technology that are coming in to deal with that. And he's making an assumption that it's the same argument. It's an argument from 2018, actually. But he's talking about 2044 for when actually the last plant will shut. So we're making an argument now that's decades out of place. And really what's going to happen is we see this technology happening really fast. We know from the Australian Electricity Market Operator that there is a scenario where we can get to stay within our Paris Agreement and implement a whole bunch of new businesses around the country. That is easy to see. The challenge is, if we just keep thinking about that, you know, it's going to be an argument from 2018 to 2044, it's not going to work. We're going to get so far behind. And that just puts all of us in a really sticky situation.
So, Adam, you keep talking about this idea that we need to jump on the train. I suppose the observation that I would make is it looks like the train's already picked us up. So we're kind of on the train, whether we bought a ticket or not, like, we're on it. And if that's the case, then what exactly would that extra action that you're calling for from government, what difference, like, can you be specific about what difference it would actually make?
Yeah, absolutely. So if the government wants to get on that train right now, what we need to look at is, what does a just transition look like? How do we help those communities where they're living around coal-fired power stations that will be decommissioned? How do we help those communities start become new clean tech or new economic opportunities in those places? How do we help with regulation? Our regulation is so slow, and there's a really slow process on getting the regulation changed so that these new technologies and new social initiatives can actually have traction in the market. There are two ways that are going to help people, they can help our economy, and they'll help in the environment as we go forward. And they're actually pretty easy. We see them happening in Germany, we see them happening in the US, we see them happening around the world. We can start emulating that here.
All right. Adam, thanks so much for your time.
Great to be here. Thanks, guys.